In this chapter we have what? Projectile motion. Okay? Please write down projectile motion. So, projectile motion is the motion of an object when what happens? When gravity is acting. So, if you drop an object, gravity is acting, is it projectile motion? No. When the initial velocity has some angle with the vertical, which is not equal to 0 and 180. Okay, please write down. When an object is thrown with some velocity, velocity cannot be 0. Okay, you can't drop an object and hope that it will be a projectile motion. Alright? So with, I am talking about absolute velocity by the way. Relative velocity can be 0. Alright? So there should be some absolute velocity, and that velocity, the angle with vertical should not be equal to 0 or 180. If it is 0, which direction I am throwing? Vertically up. So it just goes up and comes down. If I am throwing it down, it just goes down in a straight line. So if it is a straight line, it comes under motion in 1D, motion in a straight line. Okay? But if angle is not 0 or 180 degree and it has some velocity, then suppose this is an example where I am throwing this pen like this. What angle it is making with vertical? 90 degree. I am throwing it like this, the angle is 90 degree. So it will go like this in a curved path. It goes like that. Okay? This path is definitely not a straight line. So it cannot be studied under motion in a straight line or motion in 1D. Okay? But definitely entire motion can be contained in a single plane. So that is why we are studying it in motion in 2D or motion in a plane. Understood? Okay? Now when this kind of thing happens, we are assuming here, when I write this thing, please write down in the brackets, that we are assuming the only force acting on an object is gravity. That is our assumption. Okay? The only force acting on an object is gravity force. Okay? How much is gravity force? That is gravity force. Mg is a gravity force, and it's a very strange kind of force. Why? Because the bigger the mass, more is the force. Usually what happens, if you apply a force, bigger masses will have lesser acceleration, smaller masses will have more acceleration. But here is a force which increases with the mass. Okay, so Einstein has later clarified that this is not a force itself. It is space-time continuum and space-time fabric is creating a hypothetical force. It feels like a force. Okay, more is the mass, more is the deformation in space-time fabric. But we are not getting into all that. We are studying gravity as a force whose magnitude is what? Mg. Bigger the mass, bigger is the force. Alright? So suppose you have a mass of m kgs, its velocity is like this. Let's say this is the velocity. What is the force acting on it? Only mg force, like this. Its acceleration will be what? Net force should be what? Mass into acceleration. Mg is the only force. So mg should be equal to m into a. So A will be equal to G. So M into G is M into A. So from here A is equal to G. So it does not matter what is the mass of an object, acceleration will always be G. Okay? And it also doesn't matter where is the object, what is its velocity, whatever it is. If force is mg, the acceleration is g. Direction of acceleration is downwards, always, irrespective of what is the velocity, direction of gravity is downwards. Alright? And when we are studying motion in 2D, under motion in 2D, the projectile motion, we are assuming that the object is near the earth surface. Because even small g can change its value. If you go very far from the earth, g will be different. Okay? So we are assuming that we are studying the motion near the earth surface. So g is uniform across. And how earth will look to you? Flat. Okay? So we are assuming that earth is flat. Getting it? Right? Now there can be different kinds of projectiles. Depending on what angle it is making, how it is thrown, if it is thrown from the surface and it lands on the surface only, same level, it is the example of simplest possible projectile. For example, this one. Please draw this. This is the simplest possible projectile. Tell me one thing, what are the critical factors of a projectile? Suppose I am throwing an object, what all things I need to know? Suppose I am throwing bomb to my enemy, let's say, in. Let's say you have a Bofors gun, you are in a Kargil war, you are the cannon that comes out is a projectile only. So what all things you want to control? Whatever is its velocity or angle, ultimately you want to kill your enemy. Right? You will never go, let me control my angle and velocity. No, right? You want the bomb to hit the base of the enemy, wherever the enemy is. Yes or no? That is what you want. What all things you can control?
Initial velocity.
Initial velocity and angle. Can you control gravity?
No.
Only initial velocity and angle is in your hands. Right? So, if there is a relation between initial velocity and angle with where you are going to hit, then only you can control where you are going to hit. Right? If there is no correlation between velocity, angle and where you are going to hit, you can't control anything then. Are you getting it? So when I am studying projectile motion, I will try to find out everything. The time it will take to hit the target, how far it goes, what is the maximum height it will reach, depending on initial velocity and angle. Are you getting it? Because only these two things I can control. Are you getting it? Any doubts? Alright? And throughout the chapter, throughout this study, usually we are ignoring. Please write down, the effect of air drag is ignored until and unless specified. Air resistance, effect of air resistance. When something is moving against the air, air is applying force or not? Yeah. Right? That we are ignoring. Until and unless specified, the air resistance is ignored. Air resistance is ignored. Okay? So even air resistance is not a factor. The entire projectile motion is nothing but it's a relation between initial velocity, angle and gravity g. Anything else you can think of? Anything else can you think of on which it can depend on? Nothing. If something happens, you change the acceleration due to gravity, let's say. Let's say you go to Mars and throw projectile motion. G will be different. G will be different, right? So that is why we are trying to derive the formula in terms of G. So suppose I tell you G is now G by 6. So in the formula itself, you just write G as G by 6. Fine? So whatever I am trying to derive will be as a function of magnitude of velocity, direction of velocity and acceleration due to gravity G. Understood? Alright? So let's see here, what are the critical factors you can think of in this projectile? The range. Range is the, this is range. Please write down, range is defined as the horizontal distance between initial and final points. In any projectile, range is the horizontal distance. The range is horizontal distance between initial and final points. Any doubts? Simple, right? For whatever the projectile is, suppose I am top of a building and throwing a stone. So I need to, what I am saying is this example. I am throwing a stone like this. This is a projectile or not? So this is the range. This distance is the range. Okay? Clear? This is the range. Usually range is denoted by letter R. What else I might be interested to find about projectile? Time it will take to hit the target, right? So another variable is time of flight. T is time of flight. What else? What do you think? What else could be of our interest? Angle? Angle of projection is given to you. So maximum height, right? What is the maximum possible height it can go up to? You can say that is H max. Fine? Any doubt? Alright, so right now let's keep it simple. We are going to take example of the simplest possible projectile. Simplest possible projectile, which is this. And we are trying to derive formulas for range, time of flight and maximum height for what? Simplest possible projectile. Now whatever formula you derive are valid only for this projectile, which is what? Same level. So this formula is not valid everywhere, but the way you are deriving is valid everywhere. So focus on the way it is derived. Don't focus on the final result, because they are useless. You are not going to gain anything if you just remember the final result. Understand? Okay? Alright, focus here. Listen. This is the initial velocity. Let's say initial velocity is u, it makes angle theta. It makes an angle theta. Acceleration is in which direction? Vertically down. So acceleration is this g. Okay? So you have velocity and acceleration. Now, acceleration is constant or not?
Yes.
Throughout, acceleration is down and the value is constant. So it's a constant acceleration case. So I can use equations of motion, right? I can use equations of motion. So those three equations of motion, V is equal to U plus AT. Please write down. So I can use these equations of motion. Now, we also know that these are what kind of equations? Vector equations. I cannot use velocity in one direction and acceleration in another direction. Getting it? So what should I do? To take components. And how you take component? Step number one, draw your x and y axis. What do you think the obvious x and y axis choice? Horizontal and vertical, right? So this is my, let's say, x axis and that is my y axis. So basically what I am trying to do here, I am going to find out velocity along x-axis, acceleration along x-axis, then both velocity and acceleration along y-axis. Alright? and then I'm going to use these three equations along x-axis and then along y-axis. Understood? Okay. So can you tell me what is the initial velocity along x-axis? Component of initial velocity, if you drop a perpendicular, this plus that is u. So component is u cos theta. Initial velocity along x-axis, along y-axis what it is? U sin theta. Acceleration along x-axis is what? It is 0. Acceleration along y-axis? See, you have taken upward direction positive. When you write velocity along y direction is u sin theta, you are essentially saying upward is positive. Okay, so that is why acceleration along y axis is minus g. Getting it? Okay, now I want you to write these three equations along x axis. Write down along x axis and those three equations along y axis. Just write down three equations. Between, guys, pay attention here. One more thing I wanted to say. Look at these three equations. These three equations are always used between the two points. Yes or no? Final velocity, initial velocity. Final velocity, initial velocity. Total displacement. It is always between two points. So before even you apply these three equations, you should ask between which two points you are applying this. So I am trying to apply this equation between A and B. Between A and B, please write down these three equations along x and along y axis. Please write down, do it properly. If you pay attention for just 15-20 minutes, projectile motion is done. Okay? It's very systematic study. All you have to get a small trick. That's it. What? Yes. Displacement along y axis is change in y coordinate. Guys, focus here. Please write down somewhere. Displacement along y axis is difference in y coordinates. And displacement along x axis is difference in the x coordinate. Simple, right? Difference in x coordinate is displacement along x axis. Difference in y coordinate is displacement along y axis. Okay, did you get the equations? Let's try to write the first equation along x-axis. What it will be? Final velocity. See, I am trying to use this equation along x-axis. Final velocity along x-axis, this is how I will write. This is equal to initial velocity along x-axis plus acceleration along x-axis into time. Right? Now, ux is what? U cos theta, AX is?
0.
AX is 0. So this is a very, very important finding that along x axis the velocity is constant. It doesn't depend on time. Why? Because there is no acceleration to change the velocity. Getting it? If there is acceleration along x axis, then only the velocity can be changed. If acceleration is 0, velocity along x axis will not be changed. So velocity on x-axis in a projectile under gravity will be same. When I say x-axis, I mean to say horizontal direction. You can choose either x and y-axis and inclined also. Okay? Getting it? So this is one of the important finding. What about y-axis? How will you write velocity on y-axis equals to?
U sin theta
minus g into total time of flight t. I don't know what is t. Any doubts here? This is the first equation. What about second one? Second one, can you write? S is what? Along x-axis, what is s? R. Right? So r is equal to u cos theta into
t.
Is this t same as that t?
Yes.
And what? Plus?
Zero.
It is zero. A is zero along x-axis. All of you understood? Now write down here. Along y-axis, what is the displacement?
Sin theta.
Displacement is between this point and that point. Both have same y coordinate.
Yeah.
Getting it? Are you with me? Understood? Displacement along y axis is 0. So that is why 0 is equal to what?
U cos theta.
U cos theta or u sin theta? U sin theta. Minus half g. Now, using this equation, can I find the value of capital T? Right? I can get the value of T, which is what? I can simplify and I will get 2u sin theta by g. So time of flight I have got. Time of flight is 2u sin theta by g. So can I substitute this time to get r value also? How much is r?
2u sin theta cos theta.
2u square sin theta cos theta by g. Yes or no? So r is 2u square sin theta cos theta by g. All of you understood this? Understood?
Yes,
now look at this equation. R is equal to sin theta into cos theta. There is sin theta into cos theta. Suppose theta is 30 degrees. Suppose theta is 30 degrees. So it will be what? Sin 30, cos 30. Now if I tell you theta is 60 degrees, it will be same. Are you understanding this? Sin 30 into cos 30 is same as sin 60 into cos 60. Because cos 60 is sin 30. And cos 60 is sin 30. Cos 30 is sin 60. Are you getting it? Okay, I think. What I am saying is, if you substitute theta as 90 minus theta, then what will happen to range? 2u square sine of 90 minus theta cos of 90 minus theta. This is same as the earlier one. 2u square sin theta cos theta by g. Yes or no? So for a particular range, you have two angles of projection. Some of the two angles will be 90 degrees. If some of the two angles is 90 degree, they will have same range. Please write down. If some of the angle of projections are 90 degree, some of the angle of projections is 90 degrees, okay? Then for a given initial velocity, range is same. Range is same. R is same. Understood? Okay? Now just one small thing. Can you find out the H max? To find H max, what you should do? Is H max displacement along X axis or Y axis?
Y.
And do you know how much time it will take to go to H max? Half of total time, yes or no? Due to symmetry, please write down, due to symmetry, the time taken to go to maximum height is total time divided by 2, which is what? U sin theta by g. So can you use s equal to ut plus half at square along y axis between point A and C? Please do it quickly and tell me what is the answer. Time, you know what is the time it takes to go to C. Please use s equal to ut plus half at square between A and C. Time is what? U sin theta by g. U sin theta is velocity of y axis. T is what? U sin theta by g. minus half times g into t square, which is u square sine square theta by g square. One of the g will get cancelled away. Okay, so from here, what is displacement you are getting? U square sine square theta by u g. Understood? Please copy it down quickly. And can you answer one question, that suppose it is not symmetrical, suppose it is like this, if I throw a projectile like that and then I am trying to find the maximum height,
you have to get that here and add it
because what is the condition for maximum height? That's what I am asking. Velocity along y axis is zero. That is actually a better way to solve this question. Velocity, please write down at maximum height. At maximum height, velocity along y axis is zero. Can you use this condition to get the maximum height?
Yeah.
Which equation you will be using? Use it quickly. Square plus 2as along the vertical direction between A and C. V is what? 0. U is u square sine square theta. A is minus g. S is sy. So sy will come out to be u square sine square theta by 2g. Same thing we have derived like that. This is much better way to solve, because this method you can use everywhere. Getting it? Okay. So next class we'll continue with the projectile motion. We'll be taking different kinds of projectile motions. Okay.